Okay, so it is intimidating to speak on infectious keratitis with you guys because you are all experts and you see also very complex infections and have a lot of experience in dealing with fungal keratitis, but I'll try to do my best. What I'm going to present is totally experimental. It is still not FDA approved, and we hope soon could be available for us and the rest of the world. This has been a team approach. This is a project that I've been working on for years now, and we have many fellows that have contributed. And the main engine right now is Dr. Diego Altamirano, but you met in the Ambala meeting Jaime, my fellow, and some others. So I really want to give credit to them. We see all kinds of ulcers, and we try our very best. And most of the time, we can succeed with the antibiotics and the antifungals and the antiparasitic medications that we have. But sometimes we don't. And I think the most important when you're dealing with infections is to know your enemy. So depending on the area that you practice, what are the organisms that you're going to encounter? For example, for us, it's the gram-negatives because we live in the water here, pools everywhere, there's the ocean. Very humid environment. We see a lot of Pseudomonas, a lot of Serratia. We also see the same number almost of fungal and gram positive, and the rest are mixed organisms of Acinocardia, Mycobacteria, Cantamoeba. So I think we have very good treatment for bacterial and viral ulcers. We have enough weapons to, but for atypical bacteria, we don't have a lot for mycobacteria. But for fungal and parasitic, I think there's a lot of room for improvement. We haven't seen many new medications for this. Maybe for parasitic, the new medication, miltefosine, systemic miltefosine. We just published something on that. Maybe something that will share. But these are the cases that you all see, and it's very difficult because the infection starts to approach the sclera, and we have to do a graft. We have to do a large diameter graft, and it's a fungal organism. We're afraid to use steroids, and then this graft failed. And we've been seeing some publications, so we saw some publications some years ago about the possibility that cross-linking could help the infections because it made sense. It makes the cornea stronger. It makes the cornea more resistant to degradation of its enzymes. And it may also have some antibacterial or debilitating the microorganisms. But we didn't have very good luck in vitro to deal with the fungal infection. So this is the first patient we ever did. This is back maybe 7 years ago, 6 years ago, with a fulminant Pseudomonas infection that we use our cross-linking machine. This is at that time, Avitro was not approved in the United States. And our engineer, Dr. Jean-Marie Perel, developed this custom made Dresden protocol UV light radiator. So we treated the patient following the Dresden protocol, put an amniotic membrane, and eventually the patient healed without a perforation. The cornea was quiet. 6 months later, we transplanted the patient, and this patient already has two beautiful kids and is doing very well with no episodes of graft rejection. We have removed all the sutures, and she continues to do well. We didn't continue using cross-linking because our main interest was to treat fungal infections. And in vitro, we were unable to treat them. But, you know, there is a group, there are all the groups interested. Dr. Hafezi in Switzerland has been a big proponent of this. And he is now pushing the envelope about using higher fluents in order to accomplish and killing the organism. There are a few cases with the PAXI-XL protocol. We already published that, and these were in difficult cases, such as the one I showed you with the Pseudomonas, a Mycobacteria, and a Curvellaria. With decent results. But we decided to move forward with a different photosensitizing agent. We looked at different photosensitizing agents, and we decided to pick Rose Bengal because it's something that we are very familiar as ocular surface specialists. And Rose Bengal is a photosensitizing agent that gets activated with the green light spectrum. We develop a custom-made LED UV, and sorry, green fluorescent light. And we did this because there's also enough data published that green light with Rose Bengal could cause stiffening of the collagen, increase resistance to enzymatic degradation. It is safe for the intraocular structures and for the limbus. And this is all from different groups that have been working on using Rose Bengal for refractive purposes for the treatment of ectasia or keratoconus. So we use their data, and we started some collaborations with them. But we are only interested in the infectious disease part of the treatment. We're not using this for the treatment of ectasia, though some groups are doing that. So from the UV light radiator, Dr. Perel built a green fluorescent radiator. Our first publication was this one, where we treated with the Dresden protocol, Fusarium, Aspergillus, and Candida, and we were unable to kill the organism. But here we were able to do it with the Rose Bengal, and this is the area of irradiation, the circle that you see right there. We were very happy with that, so we decided to move forward with different organisms such as resistant staph and also resistant Pseudomonas. We've been collaborating early on with, you can see here, people that you may know in some of our publications, like Nidhi was here and Mukesh was also helping us. Then we started to apply for FDA so the FDA could let us do this. They asked us for a safety study, so we did a safety study where we show that it was safe to the endothelium and it was safe to the epithelium. This is published in this manuscript. This was done with the rabbit study. When we felt that the procedure was safe, we had a patient with a very complex fusarium infection that was not responding to anything. She had a large diameter graft that lasted many years for keratoconus that was done somewhere else. And she was using a rigid gas permeable contact lens. So the treatment started on day 45 after aggressive treatment with everything that we had. But we sent the fusarium to a lab in Texas that showed that the fusarium was very resistant to most of the antifungals that we have. So we took the sample from this fusarium, we grew it in the lab, and we showed that we could kill it with Rose Bengal. So we offered that to the patient. And this was our first publication in humans that we did. So then we started offering this to patients as a last resource before jumping into surgery, and that's our publication in AJO. Now, there's been correct criticism about this publication. It's not a very scientific publication, but our goal was to just share our experience, share our results with you, and learn from them. So most of these cases were very severe. We think we were able to prevent surgery in many of those cases. So these are some examples. This is an acanthamoeba patient. This is actually the son of an ophthalmologist. He's actually an ophthalmologist from India that now works here in Florida. And he was a member of a college tennis team, a very good tennis player. And he developed this contact lens related acanthamoeba. And within 2 weeks of the treatment, he was able to heal. And 6 months later, we did a graft. This was another acanthamoeba, and all of these are in our publications. But you can see that these are not easy ulcers. These are real ulcers that were treated, and we were able to do optical grafts or lamellar or penetrating in the ones that needed. And the interesting thing is that a lot, actually, I would say all of them, and I knock on wood, we haven't seen a graft rejection in any of these patients. There's a group in Germany describing the use of photodynamic therapy to decrease the lymphangiogenesis that happens in these patients. And this may be an area of opportunity. This is an acanthamoeba patient that we treated. And even though with treatment, she perforated, she had a microperforation, and we had to do a large diameter graft, and she's still 3 years out with this graft, and she has a very good vision. So it's not just us. There's another group that has also started publishing on this. They are interested specifically on acanthamoeba, and they have some interesting data that shows that acanthamoeba can be killed with the Rose Bengal photodynamic therapy with the green light in vitro and in rabbits. There's actually another group in Brazil, Dr. Ana Luisa Hofflin, who is replicating our studies over there and just presented to us a couple of weeks ago. And it's very interesting to see that she's also having the same results, even with mycobacteria. We haven't had this good results in acanthamoeba in vitro, but we've had it in vivo. So I think there's still a lot to learn. And to finish, you know, I think, you know, this Rose Bengal concept is not new. Dr. Koshubar, who's one of our collaborators, came to lecture us. I borrowed this slide. They are using this in Boston in the dermatology field to seal wounds, to cross-link these wounds. You can see here with the photodynamic therapy with Rose Bengal and sutures. They're using the same concept of the photodynamic reaction to release this single oxygen species to treat some cancers. There is a company doing intravenous Rose Bengal for the treatment of some melanomas. And in Boston specifically, they're trying to seal better the wounds, doing this cross-linking and sealing an amniotic membrane in small to medium-sized perforations and showing, they have show actually that the effect is beneficial. They have raising the pressure in experimental models, showing that the wound gets very strong. You can see here the pressure transducer, and you can see how with the Rhodes Bengal, the wounds are